And welcome everyone to today's webinar. My name is Derek Terrell and I'm the Director of Member Engagement here with the Coalition for College. We're using the Zoom webinar feature today, which has the Q&A function enabled. So feel free to ask your questions throughout the presentation and we'll try to answer them during the Q&A portion at the end. Just so you know, we did have a lot of really great questions submitted. So we'll try to get through those first and then we'll hit the ones that are in the Q&A. First, let me give you all some information about the Coalition for College and the work that we do. The Coalition is more than 150 colleges and universities with a proven commitment to access, affordability, and student success. So we believe that Coalition schools are smart college choices because of the commitment that they all share to graduating students on time with low to no debt, including those who have been historically excluded and underrepresented in higher education. Members of the Coalition provide a variety of smart college choices for students to explore and apply to with a wide range of student body sizes, as well as levels of selectivity. And still collectively, Coalition schools do outperform national averages by about 17% when it comes to retention and graduation rates, which are very important factors that you should consider when you think about the time and money that you'd like to invest in your education. So when you're thinking about finalizing your college list, definitely take a look at the over 150 Coalition schools that are dedicated to making a college education accessible and affordable. So the Coalition and its members also provide a set of tools called My Coalition to help students learn about, prepare for, and apply to college. You can get access to these by creating your free account at mycoalition.org. You can also follow us on Instagram to bring some of that insight and inspiration to your feed at Coalition for College on Instagram. If you do have any questions after this session today, feel free to reach out to us via our info box at info@coalitionforcollege.org. Without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and get us started here. So we have some amazing Coalition member schools with us today, NC State, Penn State, Stanford, and Syracuse. And before we get into the Q&A portion, I'm gonna ask each of the presenters to introduce themselves going down this list here and to answer a question for me. This is actually a question that was submitted a lot during the registration. So a lot of you all had this question. So the one that I will ask each of you to answer is, why did you pursue college and was it worth it? And we're gonna kick things off with Kaylee.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for joining in. I'm Kaylee Watkins. I work with NC State University, and I'm also an NC State University graduate. So when I was in high school, I knew I wanted to go to college, but had no idea what I wanted to study. But the reason that I thought, you know, college, it's a good path, it's because I wanted to leave a lot of doors open so that whatever I did decide on doing, I basically had a degree and a solid foundation to be able to go into that. And then was it worth it? Absolutely. Here I am in a career path that I never expected, but I absolutely love what I do. And being able to work with students like you all listening in definitely makes my day. So yep, it definitely a worthwhile experience. And thank y'all so much.
Okay. Hi, everybody. My name is Isabel. I am an admissions counselor at Penn State. I work primarily with students from California, but right now also working with students basically in the entire western half of the U.S. for our team. The question of going to college, I was privileged in the sense that it was something that was always expected in my family. I'm not a first gen, so I was lucky in that sense. My background is actually music, so in the line of work of if you want to be a music educator and a performer, that additional training in the college after high school is kind of necessary in that field. Is it worth it? Absolutely. Because again, the training was necessary in my field, as well as the networking that you get in that type of education. And I think that applies to a lot of different fields as well. As long as you're smart and you do your research, definitely worthwhile. Yep.
Hi, good evening. My name is Jamilet Medina Lopez. I'm not a first generation student, but I actually did get to go to my mom's college graduation. So I knew I was gonna go to college, but I wasn't sure like how I was gonna go to college. And so it was something that was definitely ingrained in our family as far as a cultural value. And it definitely, you know, the reason I decided to pursue it was more than a career I wanted to explore. I actually wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. And so college gave me sort of that opportunity to really think about different careers. I thought I was going to be a physical therapist, and I'm a college admission officer. So, you know, it definitely broadened my horizons. I definitely feel it was very much worth it. I went to college very far from home. I went to college 3,000 miles away from home. And so just the experience and all of the things that I got to experience in terms of growing, maturing, independence, just so many things that really, for me, made it completely worth it. And it allows me to do this job that I love. I've been an admission officer for over 16 years. And I love talking to students that are in the process of this transition. So thank you so much.
Sorry, my mouse wasn't working. It was disagreeing with me. And I said to Yamileta a minute ago, I forgot how to unmute, and it's so true. I'm Peter Hagen. I'm director of admission at Syracuse, and I've been at Syracuse forever by mistake. And because I always knew, or it was sort of my sense that I would go to college, and I became sort of a college admissions junkie. I think I figured out that I wanted to do this job when I was on a tour. But I think for some of the same reasons that Jamilet mentioned, college taught me so much about myself and the world around me that it was totally worth it.
Awesome. Thank you so much, you all. So we're going to go ahead and get things started. So the first question that I have that was submitted, I'm going to direct to Isabel. So one of the students wanted to know, who can help me if I don't have a college counselor?
That is a great question. So a lot of different resources you can go to. Kind of just off the top of my head, I would say if you have a teacher that you have a really strong connection with, even if they're not, if they teach a subject that you're not necessarily interested in pursuing in college, that doesn't matter. They went through the college admissions process and can kind of give you some guidance, can kind of give you some perspective and advice on the process. If you have any other kind of adults in your life, whether it's at a youth group, maybe an older sibling, cousins or anything like that, that have gone through college or are currently in college, they can oftentimes be a great resource for, again, insight, advice, just to kind of give you some things to think about and some pointers. I think the most obvious one that we all here on this panel will say is to reach out to folks like us, Peter, Yamilet, Kaylee. There are admissions counselors at virtually every school that you might be interested in, and our jobs are to reach out to you and to guide you every step of the way. Of course, we are, our titles are attached to a specific institution, but I think I can safely say that, you know, we're happy to help guide you through the general admissions process, not just at our school, but to help you find what the best type fit institutions are for you, maybe specific majors that would help help you pursue and meet your professional personal goals. So if you don't have anybody else, find an admissions counselor at one school that you might be interested in and just start a conversation and see where it goes. And they can help direct you to a lot of great resources.
Awesome. Thank you, Isabel. The next question I have is for Jamilet. So what advice do you have for first generation to college students as they approach the admissions process?
Yeah, I mean, so I mentioned that I'm not first generation, but my mom graduated college when I was in high school. So I got to kind of see a little bit of that process. I did grow up outside of the mainland. So I grew up in Puerto Rico. So we refer to the U.S. is the mainland. So it was a very different process. And one thing that I wish someone would have told me was to ask more questions, right? Because I think, you know, and I certainly see this with a lot of the first generation students that I work with, is sometimes there is hesitation about asking questions. And the question could be, look, I don't even know what to ask. Like, I am doing this process for the first time, and I really need some guidance. And so, you know, certainly happy to help students, even if they're not applying to my institution. A lot of the work that we do with community-based organizations, for example, you'll hear CBOs, I help students that are probably not applying to my institution. And so if you are connected with one of those groups, definitely ask as many questions as you can. And the other thing is, there are a lot of tools to do research. And so the coalition actually has some really great tools for students who are exploring different colleges. Maybe you don't know where to start. And so sometimes it's, you know, using some of these questionnaires to kind of help you narrow some things down, right? You're not really sure about, you know, there's so many universities, right? So how do I pick? And so I think, again, it's really making a list of like, what are the things that you are looking for, and asking a lot of questions are two, I would say, two main things that can really help you as a first generation college student. And the last thing is, I think a lot of times when we look at costs, we're immediately deterred. We also have to ask questions about financial aid. And so, you know, I think for me, definitely my parents not understanding sort of what schools could cover in terms of costs and things like that did limit the knowledge that I had in terms of the schools that I looked at, because there was this fear of, we can't afford this. And in reality, we probably just didn't ask the right questions about financial aid. And so it's okay to ask, you know, this is something that I'm worried about. How can you all help with the cost of my education? And so I think those are three things that I'll offer, and I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thanks for that. The next question that I have, and I guess this kind of goes to what this session is all about, ask us anything. We have folks on the call tonight who are just getting started with the admissions process, who are in the admissions process, some are thinking about transferring. So the next question that I have is actually for you, Peter. So one student wants to know, can I still apply for admissions for fall 2022?
I was totally ready to unmute that time. And I think the answer, and this is often an answer, it's sort of an eye roll answer for admissions officers, which is it depends. But it depends is one of the things that I think makes higher education great in the US, is that there is a lot of customization. There's a lot of different kinds of schools. I think if you are a prospective first year student, there are lots of great colleges that are still accepting applications. And sometimes that might be blatantly apparent. Their deadlines might not have passed, or they might not have deadlines. But sometimes you might have to call and ask. And I think if you're a transfer student, there are many schools that are still accepting applications for fall 2022, many like mine included. The transfer deadline is later on in the process. And so if there are places you're interested in, you know, quick web searches, and sometimes a quick phone call or an email will sort of suss out whether or not an application at this point is still an option, even if the deadline has passed.
Awesome. So quickly, just by a show of hands, are any of the institutions on the call tonight accepting first year applications still? Okay, so Penn State and NC State are still. For the ones who are on the call tonight, have any of your transfer application dates passed, or are you still accepting transfer applicants by a show of hands? Okay, so Syracuse, NC State, and Penn State have open deadlines right now for transfer applicants. Awesome, thanks so much. The next question I'm gonna throw over to you, Kaylee. So are the SAT or ACT still required? And if a school is test optional, does it even matter?
This is a great question, and it's going to be a little bit like Peter's response in that it does depend on the school. So just like Peter said, giving the school a quick phone call to ask what their policies look for this year or for next year is going to be the best way to get the most accurate information there, or by checking websites. So a lot of schools have been test optional just because of limited testing opportunities because of COVID. But in some cases, like with NC State, it was a limited time waiver. So it's not guaranteed at all that test scores will be waived for 2023 or moving forward. Some schools are test optional totally. So it really does depend. And then in terms of if it matters, that depends a little bit by school too. So if a school is test optional, typically with NC State, it doesn't hurt you or disadvantage you if you choose not to submit scores because they are optional. So there's a lot of terminology when it comes to like test optional, test blind. So definitely something to look into a little more, and then talk with each institution that you're interested in to get a better idea of how it works for them.
Great. And another question for you, Peter. One student wanted to know, how should I approach the college essay questions? Is there anything that I should focus on?
No, I think sometimes the best way that you can present yourself to colleges through things like the essay and other short answer questions and parts of the application that sort of where the story isn't told yet, right? Like your transcript is what it is, but we give you this place like the essay or other spaces to be you. We all represent faculty members who are interested in educating new college students. And so I think what I would say is don't spend time thinking about what you think we want to know. Because the reason we do what we do is we like the transition and that what we believe is a transformative experience to move from into a college experience. So you be you. And that's in the essay and everywhere else. Like, if the words aren't coming, wait, spend some time, come back later, but don't overdo it. It's easy to spot an overdone essay, right? Am I right? Did anyone read an overdone essay today? Yes. They're not our favorite.
Awesome, thank you. So it's looking like a couple of questions are coming into the Q&A around AP scores. So I just wanna bring that up now since we just talked about SAT and ACT. So a student asks, how important are AP exams and how are they evaluated in the admissions process? Does someone want to take that question?
I can take it. I mean, I think it's interesting. One of the questions I saw, so I'll lump it because it's AP related with this is, do I take APs if my school doesn't offer it? I think, first of all, we really, and if anybody on the screen does things a little differently, you'll hear people talk about their process. But for schools that do holistic review, right, we are really looking at what is offered in your school. And so again, when you're thinking about adding AP courses, it shouldn't be something just to check it off the list, right? Every student that is admitted to Stanford doesn't have every single AP in their coursework. They may have coursework AP in courses that are related to their interests, right? And naturally, some students just have a lot of interest in taking advanced coursework. So I think the question is more around, really thinking about what you're doing with that advanced coursework, why are you making those choices? And not so much just like, let me take every possible AP that's available just because I can, right? Because sometimes it doesn't give you a healthy balance. And then it doesn't allow you to do other things extracurricularly, right? That you might want to do, because when you take some of these advanced courses, there's a lot of additional things that you have to do outside of the classroom, right, for those classes. And so, again, I think it's about talking with someone at school that is helping you build that schedule and really thinking about what you can handle more than just checking things off and adding it and making sure that I've taken every class. If your school offers advanced coursework, and I say advanced coursework because not every school offers APs. For some schools, it might be international baccalaureate, IB. For some schools, it may be none of that. They may have their own college prep courses, right? So we really have to understand what the school offers and go from there. And in terms of AP testing, that is another one of those, it depends. There are schools that will be very specific and they will ask for AP scores. There are schools that will not. And then, for some schools, again, it's more about, it's an added piece of information to your application. It's not just, well, if you have this number of APs, then I'm automatically in, right? It's added information. And again, it's all about how you are choosing that coursework and why you're choosing it. So hopefully that helps.
Thank you. The next question that I have, I'm going to direct towards Kaylee. So Kaylee, what are admissions officers really looking for in an applicant?
So there are lots of different factors. Yamilet kind of mentioned the holistic review process. So a lot of schools, not all, but a lot of schools do use that type of review. And basically what it means is there are a lot of different factors that are taken into consideration. Academics in some cases may be at the forefront, maybe primary. That's the case for NC State. So looking at your grades, looking at the types of courses you're taking, if your school offers advanced courses, are you taking advantage of that, but still, of course, having that balance. And then extracurriculars, that's definitely a big part of the admissions review as well. Essays tie in there. And then also looking at high school context in terms of like where your school may be located. Is it in a rural area? Are you a first generation college student? So many different factors that come into play. But definitely just kind of across the board, I think looking to make sure that students are prepared and able to perform at the colleges that they're applying for is kind of the general gist of what admissions offers are looking to see.
Thank you. And the next question for you, Isabel, is how many admissions counselors really or actually read my application?
Yeah, this is not the first time you'll hear this, and it won't be the last tonight. It depends on the school. So, you know, there are some institutions where an application will go through multiple rounds, multiple readers to kind of go through a selection and a cutting process. I'm speaking specifically for my institution, Penn State. We have a team of counselors whose main role is to read applications. So basically, an application will be read by an admissions counselor on that team to determine, because our main focus when we read, we don't have as much of a holistic review because of the volume of our applications. So our main focus is going to be the academic record of the student. We don't focus on essays or letters of recommendation or anything like that. So it's really, does this student make the cut academically for the program that they're applying to? But other schools, they do a very full holistic review. So that might take more people looking at that application. But there are some caveats to that too. Like I mentioned before, I work primarily with California students. So there are times when I will be asked to read specific applications for a California student. If the evaluation team needs a little bit more insight or input, they'll come to someone like me or other folks on my out-of-state team for a little bit more personalized review. But if my colleagues at other institutions kind of have a different system, I'm sure they can share as well.
All right.
I will say, I think that was a good summary. It just really depends on the institution. And I know like people get tired of hearing us say it depends, but it really depends on the school, right? So, you know, at a school like Stanford, there are multiple readers and multiple reviews that an application goes to, because then we go to committee. And so we spend about a month in committee talking about the students that have gone through the review process. I worked at a previous institution where we didn't do it that way, right? And so it was a team of three readers, and we went through the different territories that folks were assigned. So, right, so I, for example, read applications for all of the students that apply from Georgia. I read applications for all of our international students from the Caribbean. I read, you know, applications for my hometown, for Puerto Rico. So, you know, I will say, like, depending on those things can also make that process a little different at every institution. So I just think that there's not only one right answer to that question.
Thank you. And actually, the next question is for you, Jamila. So you had mentioned going, 3,000 or so miles away from home. So one student actually wanted to know that they really, or asked, they really want to go out of state for college, but they want to know, how can they convince their parents that they're ready to leave home and be on their own in college?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think, you know, it's interesting because you have to really know if you are prepared for that. Like, it was a question that I really had to sit with for a long time. I think it is really exciting to think about that. And I was like, I want to go as far away as possible. And then I really started to think about what that meant for me, right? There was no direct flight home. There were like different things that I had to consider in terms of being away. And so it was a really big decision, but I think the way that my parents knew I was ready is that I thought about all those things and I talked to them about them. Like, I've thought about what it means that I won't be able to come home for every holiday, what it means in terms of, you know, I was a low-income student. And so I did not get to just, every time the university was closed, I didn't get to go home. Sometimes I stayed with friends that would invite me to their houses. Sometimes I worked over summer, and so I would get housing on campus, but I wasn't able to always just go home. And I think I had that conversation and being able to tell my mom, because I grew up in a single parent family, hey, I've thought about all those things and I know it's going to be hard, but if you can support me when those times get really tough, like, I think I can do this. And so I think you do have to be very honest with yourself. There are a lot of other costs that you have to think about. And, you know, again, these are things that schools can help with. There are, you know, for example, I know at my current institution, there are grants that students can apply for if they're low income and need, again, some extra funding during certain times, right? That's not possible everywhere, but those are things that you can ask. And those are things that make parents feel a little bit more comfortable because they may know that there is additional support there. And so you just really have to do your research, but at the end of the day, you have to be really honest with yourself about the things that you are gonna run into. I will say for me, I still think it was the best possible decision I could have made. It really challenged me in a way that I wouldn't have been challenged if I would have stayed closer to home. And so I really feel very grateful that I got to do that.
Awesome, thank you. The next question that I have is for you, Peter. So is the admissions process different for homeschooled students? And what should homeschool students do for recommendations and accreditation of their transcripts?
Thanks, Derek. You know, I think it can be. I think there are often some distinctions and you want to follow your state Department of Education or your local Department of Education will probably have rules for like in New York State, for example, there's some documents that homeschool students sort of work with their local school districts to produce to indicate that their homeschool experience was equivalent to what they would have received at the local high school or they worked through an association. But I would imagine that all of our websites spell out any different requirements that we would have for homeschool students. And I work at a place that enrolls a few homeschool students every year. And we do offer, and I know others may also offer personal interviews as part of the admissions process. And so sometimes for students who are homeschooled or whose educational path has been different from many of our applicants for any number of reasons, an interview might be an opportunity to ask questions about anything you might need to do differently, but also to help us get to know you better on any level. So I think check the web, but also, you know, work through whatever association you might be working with and your local school district on any documents that need to happen. Sometimes even I know homeschool students, if they may have to even get a GED to meet state requirements. And even as a private institution, we still have to follow what the state says. So it can be a little wonky sometimes.
Thanks, Peter. So you just mentioned interviews. So just want to see how many of the institutions that are here tonight offer interviews. Okay, so Syracuse and Stanford have interviews. Awesome. So do you have any advice for students in the interview process, Jamilet? And also, what role does it play in the admissions decision in that process?
Yeah, I think this is a good opportunity to talk about different types of interviews too, because there are some places where interviews are optional. There are places much, much smaller than my institution where interviews might be required. And there are places where they might be required for certain programs. So first thing is to kind of understand what type of interview process the school that you're interested in is offering. If a process is optional, right? It truly is optional. And so you have to understand, and again, this is why each school, it's a little bit different, right? In a smaller school, they may really want that interview because they want to get to know you at a very personal level. They may only admit a couple hundred students, and that's how they really get to connect with students. At a place like Stanford, it's an optional opportunity for you to speak with an alumni. It's an alumni interview. So that's a little bit of a different process, right? You're not speaking with someone from the admission office. And so those tend to be really they can add information, but they're not evaluative in the sense that if the interview is not a certain, you know, type of interview, then that student's not admitted. So they tend to be more conversational. It's just really more about getting to know the student. And really, again, we look at it from the perspective of, is it adding something to, you know, to this admission file? And the other thing is capacity. Like many schools that do offer interviews, my previous institution used to offer interviews, and we could only interview about 15% of the entire applicant pool because the applicant pool was so large, right? And so again, I don't think just because something is there, you don't have to do it. You want to find out what is, you know, sort of what type of interview. If it is required, then that's a different, right? That's a whole different set of rules. But, you know, if it makes you really uncomfortable to have to sit across someone and just talk about yourself for 30 minutes, maybe just writing about yourself is a better tool, right? And so you don't have to go through that process. So again, the first thing is to understand what type of interview is offered and really, again, how it's used. Is it evaluative or is it additive? And so that's what I can share.
Awesome. So it seems like there are a couple of questions in the Q&A about awards and extracurricular activities. So Kaylee, how important are extracurricular activities? And then one student also asked, is there such a thing as too many?
That's a good question. So this, again, it does depend on the school. Like we've heard a little bit about today, some schools really are more academically focused. Other schools do take that holistic approach. So speaking more to the holistic approach, then activities, honors, awards, involvement, all of that is taken into account during that review process. So it really depends on the school how much value is placed on that specific section. In some cases, it may be something that adds a lot of value. In other cases, it may be like a helpful additive, but academics are really what's going to drive the process. And then as far as too many activities, so my advice to students is always like, don't overload yourself with every single activity because you want to list it on your resume or on your application. Truly get involved in things that are interesting to you. A lot of times those activities can really help you determine what major you may want to go into or where your interests really lie in a future career. A lot of times like we'll tell students at NC State is it's really like in some cases more about the like quality of your activities rather than quantity. So if there's something that you've been very involved in throughout all 4 years of high school, it's taken up most of your time outside of the classroom, that's perfectly fine. If you have like one activity, but many hours in that activity, in some cases that's looked at just as well as if you have 10 different activities, but you aren't as invested in them. So it really depends on you and kind of what you personally prefer.
Awesome. I'm going to do a follow-up question to that because I see someone ask this about what type of extracurriculars to do for a specific school. Does anyone want to touch on that? I think we get that question a lot, like what should I do to get into such and such school? So what type of advice or wisdom do you all have to share?
There is no specific activity that we are looking for. I think Kaylee made a really good point. Like sometimes I will see someone who is very dedicated to the arts. And so maybe those are the only types of activities that I see. And that's okay because that is what that student has really chosen to dedicate their time to. It's less about the activity itself and more about how you are choosing to spend your time, right? And why you're choosing to spend your time that way. So there is no specific activity. I see students with a wide range of activities and there's not a preference of one over others. There's some that we see more commonly, right? Like if I said Model UN, like a lot of students may know what that is because they may have a chapter at their school. And then there's other things that I've never heard of in my life, and I'm learning about them for the first time through the application process. And that's awesome because I get to, again, learn about you and what you're doing and why you're doing it. And it's not so much about the activity itself. So I think you just have to really you really have to kind of push against that kind of thinking when you start thinking that way, like, oh, I see this a lot. People will go online, they will look at videos of people who got into our institutions and they talk about the activities they did. And they're like, oh, that's what I have to do. And I mean, if you looked at how many, you know, how different our students are as they come in, you will see that they, some have similar activities and some have very different activities. So there's not a magic list.
I do want to add something else really quickly that I thought of. So when we talk about activities, I feel like a lot of times it, like your brain might go to, okay, clubs at school, volunteering. I also encourage students, if you are working full-time or part-time, if you are helping out a lot at home with either siblings or family members, I always encourage you to add that information to that activity section or somewhere else in your application, because that's important for admissions officers to know. It's more about how you spend your time outside of the classroom. So think beyond just like the clubs at school and more about like, what are you, where is your time going outside of the classroom?
That is excellent advice. That actually goes to a question that was asked in the Q&A that I would like to address. So a student wanted to know, do you have any advice for balancing your own personal college and career interests with the expectations from your family, especially if the expectations and goals that they have are different from yours?
I can jump in. I think that can be really hard, depending on the dynamics in your family and what your relationships are like. I think sometimes you have to keep in perspective who's going to college and what you hope to accomplish from that. But, you know, I think for the person asking that question, like the sort of emotional maturity and wherewithal to ask it to begin with would indicate to me that you're probably in a position or hopefully in a position where you could begin to unpack perhaps some of what's behind your family's expectations and motivations. And so, you know, and explain that, you know, like there's a world of opportunity that exists across the spectrum of American higher education that sometimes people don't realize at first. So, but sometimes that's not possible. Like sometimes those conversations are hard to have, and there are gaps in expectations, and I recognize that. But I think if you have other people and other adults who are supportive and can help you sort of negotiate some of those conversations or how to approach that, that might be one piece of advice. But I think again, every circumstance can be different, and I can understand how that could be challenging.
Thanks, Peter. And Isabel, how would a student know that a college is the best fit for them?
Okay, I love this question because there's so many things to say about it. I will say, of course, the best fit institution for a student is going to depend on the student. So I would advise, if you truly are kind of starting from a blank page and don't know even where to begin in your college search, maybe sit down and write a list of maybe the top five, top 10 things you think you want out of your college experience. And that will vary from person to person, whether it's things like size of the school. Maybe you're looking for a really small campus size where you're going to have, you know, much more of a close one-on-one interactions with students, faculty, staff much quicker. Or maybe you really want the huge college campus experience with lots of sports, things like that. That will help narrow down your list. If you're looking for a specific environment, part of the country, you want to live in a college town, you want to live near a big city, you're from the north and you want to experience what it's like in the south, or vice versa, or East Coast versus West Coast. Maybe you want to go international, who knows? That can help as well. If you are, you know, looking for institutions that have the capacity to offer a lot of financial support, or if that's not as much of a concern for you, then that can help narrow down your choices as well. And again, obviously, like the academic offerings will play a big part as well. If you know exactly what your career goals are, maybe doing some Googling, asking again, mentors, counselors to see, you know, what programs or what schools are well known for the specific program you're interested in. If you have no idea and are looking for schools that have the undecided option, that can be a good thing to list on your on your list as well. So lots of different things to think about. And again, your list is going to be very personal and specific to you. And then once you kind of have a list and you have a more narrow focus on what you're looking for out of your academic experience in college, that can at least give you something to either, whether it's on Google and doing college searches, reaching out to admissions counselors like us, or going to your high school counselor. At least it gives you a more focused idea of what institutions are a good fit. And then the last thing I'll say about that is that there really is no best fit for a student. And I mentioned that because it can be a little bit of a stressor for a lot of students when they feel like there's one correct answer for them. And if they don't get that answer right, then they did it wrong, you know, that they got it wrong in their college search. That's not the case at all. There are so many wonderful institutions, and four of them are here this evening, but so many throughout the country, throughout the world. And there's not one perfect institution for you. There might be several. And it's all about kind of maximizing your time at the school that happens to be matched up with you through fate, destiny, however you want to think about it. Taking advantage of the time that you have there academically and also outside of the classroom to really make sure that by the time you graduate, you've gotten the most out of your college experience, and that will have made the choice of your college the right one for you at the end of the day.
Thank you. I really appreciate your answer. And one of the things that you had mentioned in there was kind of about a financial fit. So I did want to ask, as I'm looking through the Q&A, there are tons of questions about getting a scholarship for this, getting a scholarship for that, full ride scholarships. And I think really that question boils down to, how do I find an affordable college for me and my family? I'm just going to throw the question out there. Any tips or advice on how to find a college that is affordable for a student, or where would they even start?
I can start, and maybe others can jump in. But you know, I think first of all, and again, this will vary from family to family and your specific situation. There are students who are navigating this process by themselves. There are students who are navigating this process with help from caretakers, family members, right? So it's not a one approach for everybody. For most students, right, if you are approaching this process with your family, there has to be a conversation about what financially, right, how you can be supported from your family and what is not realistic. And that, you know, sometimes I think that conversation doesn't happen until later. And that's where I think students really find themselves in these situations where, unfortunately, right, they've been admitted to a school and they can't make it work. So I will say the earlier the conversation starts, really the better. This shouldn't be the last thing on the list. This should be something that you're starting to research and look at as you are preparing to apply to those schools so that you understand what the capacity of each school is. Most of us will have a lot of information on our financial aid pages. It can be overwhelming, so I will recognize that up front. There is language that we use that, you know, we may call it one thing at Stanford and you know, it may be something else at Penn State, but it's similar type of aid. And so there is some of that you have to kind of get through as you are looking at what each school offers. Some schools will have what is called a calculator on their website where families can input some information and get an estimate. Now, let me say that again. It's an estimate. It is not here's exactly what you're going to receive. And it only works if you put in the correct numbers, right? So if your numbers are a little different than what you are then reporting to the school, you're not going to get the same type of financial aid that was estimated. Now, for folks who use it and they use it in that way, the estimates are really pretty close, at least in what I've seen at many schools. But again, you have to understand the capacity of that school to fund students, right? We don't call anything a full ride because we offer need-based financial aid. So there aren't scholarships for merit, but some schools have merit scholarships, and that is part of financial aid. And so really, again, it's It's understanding all of those things. My previous institution had merit scholarships, but only a certain percentage of students would receive those, right? And so it's still a competition. And so, you know, you have to have options if your parents say, look, the only way we can afford for you to go there is for you to get a scholarship, right? So again, it's having those conversations and really using the resources that each of us have to get an estimate of what your family would be responsible for. Some schools will spell it out, right, very clearly. Like we will say, you know, if a family is making under this certain income, here's what we'll cover. For some schools, it'll vary. And so you have to start the conversation early. I think that's really my main advice for that.
Awesome. And so it seems like also from what's been said that, you know, it's going to vary by university and from institution to institution. So a lot of the questions in the Q&A about financial aid processes and practices, I think we'd all recommend you reach out to those individual institutions so they can address your unique situation. Great. So the next question that I'm going to ask is going to be addressed towards Kaylee. So a student wants to know, how can I explore majors and career paths?
Awesome. Yeah. So there are a lot of different ways. So kind of like was mentioned earlier, just kind of Googling, looking at the university websites, those I think can be really good starting points. A lot of universities will list out every single major that they offer on their main page. And then you can kind of dive a little deeper into each of those programs. It can definitely be an overwhelming process. So kind of thinking through in advance, like what do you see yourself doing? What are some things you like to do that can help you start to narrow it? But I would also say one of the most helpful things for me was basically going to events. A lot of universities will host like an open house where they introduce you to the different programs that are offered. You can go to specific sessions hosted by like the animal science department, for example, to learn more about that major. A lot of times each major has their own contact as well. So you can reach out to a more specialized person in that area to learn exactly like what can I do with this major and what do the classes involve. But I would definitely say events are a big one. If you're not able to make it in person, a lot of schools are doing virtual events. So that's definitely something worth looking into. And then also calling or emailing, that works as well. But I would definitely say events can be a big one, especially because in some cases you may be able to talk with current students that are in that major and just get that more like personalized interaction, which can really help in deciding what you may want to do.
So then that goes right into the next question, which I'm going to ask Peter. So is it okay for a student to apply to a school as undecided for their major? And they wanted to know, does their choice in major affect their admissions decision?
Yeah, it's totally okay if undecided is an option to pick it. But at a lot of institutions, including mine, students may be admitted specifically to one academic discipline or another. And so to use Syracuse as an example, we have 10 undergraduate divisions, and the lens that we read your application through is the division that you choose to apply to. And admission can be more selective between those different divisions, schools or colleges. You can be undecided in almost any of them, but you still choose a college, and some are harder to get into than others. But I worked at another institution that you were just admitted to the college. It didn't matter what your major was, and you didn't really need to choose one until the end of your sophomore year. So again, it depends, but always good to understand and know that, so that as you navigate the admissions process, you know that how to be undecided, so to speak, and how to begin in the place that's really best for you, but also how to sort of navigate the admissions process, understanding that if you sort of haphazardly choose a program that happens to be super selective and you're more open to other programs than that one, that may limit your future as a candidate in that applicant pool. But so good to understand that between places.
So, and then another question was how do I determine which schools are likely schools, target schools, and reach schools? So what, Jamilet, can you tell us some advice on how to have a balanced college list?
Yeah, I think the key is balance rather than using likely, target, reach, right? Like, because I think, again, we start to like put everything in these categories. And then when things work out differently, we feel very disappointed. And so I really like when Isabel said, you know, there's not like just one school that's the best fit. Like you have to be open to have options. And so I think when you're thinking about your list and when you're thinking about balance, you do have to pay attention to profiles for schools, right? Like that is something you have to pay attention to. Peter just mentioned, you know, there might be different, you know, admit rates depending on different programs at certain institutions. At an institution like mine, you apply to the institution. You're not admitted to any specific major, but at my previous institution, you were admitted to a specific major, right? And so those things are there are things that you have to consider as you're looking at every of the profiles of the different schools. So those profiles will tell you the number of applications, right? The number of spaces that they typically have for students in the fall. And so then you can kind of figure out from that, okay, here's kind of where I'm at in terms of that percentage, right? You can also look at, you know, what types of students are admitted in terms of, you know, academic preparation. That's been brought up multiple times today. And that even at my institution, yes, we are a holistic review institution, but the academic preparation, I would say, is center to the holistic review, right? So understanding what that might look like at the different institutions that you're applying. I'm really honest with students when I have this conversation. If you want a predictable process, there are universities that have very high admit rates and you can predict exactly, you know, sort of what it's going to be, right? If they have an eligibility model, they will tell you, you need this GPA, you need this test score. If they use testing, and here are the things you need and you will be admitted. If you're applying to an institution like mine, you can have all of those things, right? And it still may not work out. And so I think you have to be really honest with yourself. Anything that is below 20% admit rate, it is really hard to predict what is going to happen in that process. And it varies year to year because we also have our own institutional priorities and institutional sort of goals that we're trying to reach. And so again, it's about giving yourself options. And one of those things is just be realistic in terms of like, okay, so when I look at this school, if the admit rate is below 10%, then I know that all my schools on the list can't be schools that have below 10% admit rates. So then let me look at schools in the middle. And then let me look at those schools where I can predict the outcome a little bit better. And so, you know, that's kind of a quick way of kind of giving advice, but it's really, you know, one of the things that I think is really looking at just broadly and not just looking at names of schools that you recognize and really allowing yourself to sort of look at other places that maybe you're not as familiar with that could be really good options for you. So again, think about options. There's not just this is the only school that I'm going to be happy at, because again, I see students that don't end up at my institution and they do wonderful things. And sometimes they end up even in a better place. So I hope that helps.
That absolutely helps. And then as I mentioned earlier, right, we have schools that are coalition member schools with acceptance rates from 4% to 96%, all with that commitment to making your education affordable. So there are definitely many schools in the 150 plus that you can take a look at to make that balanced college list. So I know we have tons of questions still in the Q&A and a lot of others that were submitted, but we are running low on time. So I did wanna address one question here and pose this, I guess, to all of our panelists here. So one student wanted to know, do you have any advice for how students can maintain their mental health and stress levels throughout the college application process? So we can just go in the order that we introduced ourselves, if you wanna address that question or just general advice that you have as we wrap up the evening. And I believe Kaylee, you started?
Yes. So that is a really good question. And I'm glad that you asked it to the bigger group. So advice that I would give is just scheduling time for working on the college application process. It is super tedious. There are a lot of applications, and I'm sure as you've gathered, a lot of different components depend on the school or vary by school. So just designate a specific amount of time, either over the weekend or on a weeknight, and then give yourself some free time too. So I think that's definitely helpful for mental stress, is letting yourself know, okay, 2 hours tonight, I'm going to work on this, and then I'm going to cut it off and do something for me. So that's definitely something I'd recommend. And then of course, just using your resources, asking questions as they come up. I was always someone really scared to pick up the phone and call admissions for whatever reason. So if that's you, just do it. We're super friendly. We love to get your phone calls. So definitely don't be afraid to ask questions.
Oh, I think I'm next. Gosh, I feel for all of you, because I know that the college admissions process in this day and age is so much more stressful than it was when I was going through it over 20 years ago. So I would say, I would go back to what I said earlier, which is just to really try as best as you can. I know it's easier said than done, but to have the perspective of there's not one right answer for you. It's all about setting yourself up to find the best options based on what you personally want and what you're looking for. And then keeping in mind that whatever happens, you will end up at an institution that will give you some really great experiences, give you a great education, and will help prepare you for a really bright future. So if you just keep that in mind, there's really no wrong answer for you. So then that can help relieve some of the stress that kind of can be burdened on your shoulders in this day and age with the whole college search process. And know that there are a lot of people out there that are out there to support you, to help you. Just reach out. And like Haley said, we're friendly. Our job is literally to help you. So just reach out and we will do what we can.
This is hard, but it truly is something that you have to remind yourself, is that whatever decision we make is not, it really is not a reflection of you, your efforts, your accomplishments, and who you are. This decision will not make you or break you. It will not, right? And yes, I work for Stanford, and I think they're a great institution. They are not the best institution for everybody. And so it's okay, right? To remind yourself that it's not personal. It feels personal because you've spent certainly a lot of time pouring your heart and soul into the application process. But quite frankly, just, you know, if it's any consolation, there's many times where I'm not happy with an admission decision because I've really advocated for a student. And unfortunately, it hasn't worked out the way that I hope it would have worked out for that student. And so there are real human people behind this process who are invested and who care. I really care deeply about the work that I do with students. It is hard. We make some really tough decisions, but this is not a reflection of you. And so sometimes you just, you know, you have to remind yourself that as you're going through this process every day, because it can get really, you can sort of really get into your feelings when it comes to that. Especially when you start to compare admission offers with your friends, right? And so again, like you're going to be tempted to do all those things. So you really have to kind of work within yourself to keep yourself from going there, so that, you know, you can hopefully not have as much anxiety and stress as this process can cause.
I think that all great advice. You know, the public narrative around college admission can be kind of lousy. And so what I would suggest is to control the noise and figure out what sort of structures you want to create for yourself and your family for when and how you want to talk about college. And I think perhaps the one piece of advice I would give specifically to parents, but it would apply to students too, is I always think if you're lucky enough that your kitchen island is where your kids' friends want to hang out, don't wreck it for the next year, 2 years, 3 years, whatever little time you have left. by talking about everybody's college process, because it's a highly personal process. And I think the best way you can support your kids and their friends is just to be excited for where they're going to go, because you're all going to go great places and you're going to be fine. But I think you have to sort of, again, create some structures for yourself on what makes sense and how to approach it.
All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Peter, Kaylee, Jamilet, Isabel, thank you so much for sharing your words of wisdom with all the attendees here today. And thank you to the attendees for submitting some really great questions. There will be other webinars and panels hosted by the coalition, so be sure to check out our events page for those. And for the student who did ask about, will asking questions negatively affect your decision? Just know, as these admissions folks have already told you, there are real people behind the screen, behind the phone. So feel free to ask questions, and they're happy to answer them for you, just as we are happy to answer any questions that you might have here at the coalition. So with that, I'm going to say good night to everyone, or good morning, or good afternoon, wherever you are tuning into from the world, or tuning in from the wherever in the world. And we will see you at the next event. Thanks, everyone. Bye.